Hey there, welcome to the Healthy Vibes podcast. I'm Kelly Renato. Thanks so much for joining me today. I have such a treat today. I have an interview with Somer Phoebus. This might be one of my most favorite conversations so far. We talk about so much goodness, obedience over success, enjoying the season with our older, possibly adult kids, soul care, and more. Summer works so hard to empower women to embrace their God-given gifts and callings. She's the co-founder of She Works His Way, which is an amazing community for working women. She's also co-authored a book with Michelle Myers. It's called She Works His Way, a practical guide for doing what matters most in a get things done world. Such a good book that I can't recommend enough. So let's get right to it and just enjoy this conversation and all of Summer's wisdom and encouragement. Hey there, Summer. Welcome to the podcast today. I'm so excited to spend some time with you.
Oh, same here. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. I'm so excited to have you here. So much to talk about and ask you. And I know that I'm sure some of my listeners follow you already just because I've talked about you in the past, you and Michelle, and She Works His Way. But I would love first and to let you actually tell us a little bit about yourself in the season you're in, because I do follow you and obviously there's a lot more than we see, but still you're in a pretty neat season of life with your girl's age and all of that. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah, for sure. Okay, so Kent and I have been married this May. It'll be 25 years, which is so wild. Wow. I don't think we realized that. It was mid-January and we were planning out our calendar for the year and we got to our anniversary and we're like, we should probably go somewhere, maybe do something. And he said, yeah, how many years has it been? And we get the calendar out to look. And I'm like, honey, this is a big one. This is a big one. We need to do something special. But
that's exciting.
It's so sweet. We've been married for 25 years. We have two daughters who in 2023 both got married.
Wow.
So it was a crazy, crazy year. They also both married Navy officers. And those Navy officers happened to be roommates. So
oh my gosh, really? That's it.
Yeah. And both daughter, when she met the other one's future husband, called it like immediately within minutes, said, that's who you're going to marry. And they were right on about it.
Oh, so my goodness. What a story.
I know, right? It was the sweetest story. Connor and Ava live in Hawaii. Wow. Connor is on a ship out of Pearl Harbor there. And then Hunter and Kennedy live in Florida. But in the next, 3 months, they are headed to Guam. So
wow.
Yep. Wild times, but I am in my mother-in-law era. And for those of you listening who fear that season or stage of life, I will tell you it's amazing and there is nothing to be afraid of. This is very, very cool. And of course, it comes with some hard things. My kids are really far away from me, and that was not necessarily in the cards for me. I didn't know for sure they'd have to pick up and leave, but there's something really special about them being far away. They were both sick this week, actually. And so on the same day, I was Instacarting medicine, thermometers, snacks, chocolate chip cookies to both of them. And you know, like it's a different way to be a mom, but you still get to come in and kind of save the day, and they're so grateful, and so it's good. And then, of course, I have two sons. I've never had sons, so I have boys, and completely obsessed with that side of it because they're great.
Sure.
And so I serve on staff at South Shore Church in Annapolis, which is where my husband and my brother pastor, and I serve on the convention up here as the women's ministry director for Maryland and Delaware, and then the communications director there as well. And then at She Works His Way, obviously, which I know many of you are buddies of, but I'm at She Works His Way with Michelle. So yeah, I keep it nice and busy.
So all good stuff. And I love you telling us to not be scared of that season. I'm a little bit before that season, but I do have a senior graduating. So I'm like at that cusp. And then I have a freshman. So I'm at that cusp of,
I enjoy watching like moms like you in that season that are embracing it, enjoying it, and have found so much goodness in it, because it does make you realize there's goodness in all the seasons if you find it, right? So
there is. And the only thing is, I mean, if you cling to what you have, your hands are tied up. You can't grab hold on what's coming. And so I think that has been the biggest lesson for me, is me loving the season right now doesn't mean that I think less of the season previous. They're both good and they're both different, but as with every season change, you've got to get used to it. You know, if you're in a four season area and summer comes, you get hot really fast because it's been cold for a while. And towards the end of the summer, you're used to it, you know, 80 degrees is nothing. But in the beginning, it's like, wow, this is really hot. So you just have to give yourself that time to change and let your body get used to it, your mind, your heart, all of the things get used to where you are. And then once you kind of establish yourself in it, you get this, oh, okay, all right, I think I can get this down. I think I can love this. And get to be creative, like new ways to show your kids you love them and to disciple them from afar. And so, yeah, there's a lot to look forward to.
So I like that, because I say a lot that sometimes I feel like I'm like a little bit late to the new season because of what you just said. I'm still hanging on to the other one. And I have learned, when I do learn how to let go and shift into it, it makes it so much better. Like, you know, to stop, you know, missing, like you do miss it and you enjoyed it, but once you can like dive deep into this one, it definitely helps. And I don't know, do you have any tips on that for people that are hanging on to those old seasons? And
yeah, I think the biggest thing is, well, there are two things. One, if you don't grab hold tight onto anything other than Jesus, then you don't have to let go of anything. So even in your current season right now, you can fully love where you're at, but also keep your heart and mind ready for change and what is coming. And the best way to do that is just to fully live surrendered with open hands in every area. It's so much easier to move to the next thing when you're not white knuckling whatever is. And then I think the other thing is, oh my goodness, it just left me. The other thing is, whatever season that you're currently in right now, when you get to the next one, especially during that that shift part where you're trying to get used to everything and get your feet underneath you, it's really easy to romanticize the season that you came from and came out of. But you need to be realistic and remember there were days and nights and moments that were really that season. So we got to be really careful not to romanticize the season previous to the season we're in, or even the future season compared to where we are, you know, because like now I'm like, oh my gosh, grandchildren, are you kidding? This is going to be amazing. But like, I don't want to let my mind go there because I don't want to miss what is right here and what is right in front of me. Scripture talks about that, you know? So yeah, that would be
so well said. I love how you put that. That's perfect, because it's a perspective in a lot of ways. It's not even like, what do you do, but surrendering and romanticizing is, we absolutely do that wherever we aren't. That's where we're thinking the other was. So what about your marriage? And here you are at 25 years, but you know, all those years raising and now they're off, like, how do you reconnect? And, I've watched a few of the videos with you and your husband that are super cute. But so how can you guide us in that sense? Because I think I know a lot of relationships that you see that, like, what do I do now?
Yeah. Okay. So this is why I love talking to women while they're in the trenches. Not that I don't want to talk to women who are where I am exactly, but it's a prep work that I think is really important. And that is prioritizing each other, your time with each other, and just your, the value of each other before it's just the two of you. And when the kids leave, then it becomes this, oh my gosh, I don't have to fight so much for this time with you. And that makes it even more special and even more exciting. Whereas it was worth the fight when the kids were home and life was busy and soccer tournaments were every weekend, you know, you've right. got to fight for that moment. Kent and I used to, the kids always had to be at practice early. So Kent and I used to go to practice early, meet in the minivan and eat. We always got those little munchkin donuts from Dunkin' Donuts. Uh-huh. And we would set and just put like 25 of those down.
Crazy. That's awesome.
A cup of coffee and just a little car date to connect while they were warming up, you know? And if that made us a couple minutes late for the game, so be it. You know, our kids knew we were there for them, but we also had to be there for each other. And so if you do that in the beginning, if you do that while the kids are growing, then after the kids leave, I really feel like for a lot of people, it's awkward and it won't be awkward. You know, you'll just be able to move into that relationship that you've had for years. But I will tell you what we're learning is because it was after the girls left and we became empty nesters, we kind of took for granted that it was easy to just have a date night, connect when we wanted to. And then we didn't prioritize it or schedule it in. And sometimes those things are spontaneous, but a lot of times those things need to be things that you can count on. They're anchoring moments throughout your week. When you schedule something, that is a priority and it just looks like a priority. So even now, because we could, you know, go grab dinner every night and make it a date night situation, just because we can doesn't mean that it's going to scratch the same itch as what an actual real date would be. So we've learned that we still have to schedule in special time, like special moments to go and be together. And I think that's really important. We also get to be in communication, and you know, we can talk about our jobs, and luckily we're both in ministry, so that's a real help. But we can sit down and talk about our jobs, and it's not nobody gets tired of it. We have time to completely unpack our whole days and help each other through things. So finding that common ground, and it might be your kids, you know, it might be a hobby that you've taken up, but nobody's going to interrupt you. So you have this free time to just talk. And it's really, really special. Wow.
That's wonderful. Mm-hmm. That's really good to hear. And I think a lot of us deep in the seasons of it's easy to not do the prep work and prioritize, like you said. So, but I do like even the just getting to a game beforehand, having some donut holes and coffee. Cause that's, I think sometimes people, it feels overwhelming to think, where am I going to put a date night in every week? You know, the people that say
overwhelming and expensive, and who do I get to babysit and all of those things.
Yes.
So for sure. You've got to be realistic, you know? And honestly, I think some of those sneak away moments when the girls were young, were actually some of my favorite dates that we had, where you just kind of like went off to a corner of the house or went for a walk or rode to the grocery store together, you know, little things like that, that just allow you to reconnect in those moments. And then it just becomes a part of your habits.
Right. Exactly. So that's super good, good encouragement and good words. I appreciate that for all of this. Hopefully everyone's listening to that, because that is important, because that helps in that transition to that season as well. So shifting a little bit to She Works His Way, for those that might not know all that you do, can you tell us the mission and a little bit about She Works His Way?
Yeah. Okay. So She Works His Way, as Michelle and I's careers and callings have shifted, it has shifted along with us, which has been a beautiful thing. But currently the Lord really has our hearts back focused on the working woman. And now I need to preface that with, we do believe, we have a definition, a gospel definition of work that I want women to hear, because I think a lot of women hear that and they go, oh, well, I don't have a paycheck or I don't have a title, so that means it's not for me. We believe that work is anything that a believer does that they submit to God for His glory. So I would imagine the majority of your listeners work.
Absolutely. Every one of them.
Right. So at She Works His Way, we really do focus on the working woman, and we do talk a lot to the woman who's in the marketplace, who that's her mission field. We talk to the woman who is busy with multiple responsibilities. We talk to the woman whose calling is diverse, that it is not only her home and her family, but there's something else that the Lord has uniquely wired her for. And a lot of it, we're giving her permission to do what God's asked her to do and to keep the main thing the main thing. And then a lot of it is just really simple training and life hacks and experiences Michelle and I have walked through. The latest podcast we just released is how to know when it's time to quit. And we were able to go through and think through, okay, this is when my flesh is saying it's time to quit. These are the signs and symptoms. And then this is the signs and evidence of when God is telling us it's time to quit. And to kind of look at that, because I think women are walking through things like that. So Absolutely. It is our goal to train and equip working women and to encourage them to not grow weary and to stay in there and like God's called them for such a time as this, not to give up on it.
So I first of all, I love your mission and I love all your definitions because of work and all, like I just finished the book, which we'll get to about a month ago, but you and Michelle and whoever controls your feed, I don't know if it's all of your words, but yeah. I'm not a huge social media. Like I definitely am on and I try to be real careful, but I love following you guys. It's funny. It's encouraging. It like stops me in my tracks sometimes. I'm like, oh my gosh, that's like, it really shifts. Like just how you and Michelle, both of you, your words, like just make you rethink whatever it is that's heavy on you that day or whatever you're feeling. I just think you point us back to what we should be thinking about. And sometimes I can feel the heaviness like lift because I think, oh my gosh, I was kind of falling into the worldly, you know, feelings of this or that and didn't even realize it. Mm-hmm. So you do really good work there. And I hope that everyone goes to follow you and we'll make sure they find out where that is. But a lot of what you talk about that I talk about a lot too is that the hustle of the world and getting trapped and how to slow down and make sure you are chasing and making time for what matters. Yeah. And I think even like I say how a lot of what you say shifts, but I think there are many people that almost feel trapped in that hustle and yeah. they can't figure out like how to shift gears or even hear what you say and think, oh yeah, that okay, I should think about it that way. So How do you help, how do you get them that first step or to start shifting that gear of backing off of the hustle? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely know what you're saying. And I think that I'm probably talking to business women who especially get wrapped up in that. And so I'm going to use a businesswoman term called reverse engineering. And I want you to think about what the hustle is actually going to accomplish for you. And is it worth it? I think if we can ask ourselves that question and count the cost, is it worth it to hustle to a point where we're exhausted, where our bodies are unhealthy, where our families are suffering? And, you know, maybe you do get the promotion, maybe you do get the bigger paycheck, maybe you do get the recognition, but looking at what it cost you to get to that place, is it worth it? And if you're listening to this, more than likely you're a believer. So man, open God's word and you'll see, right? It's not worth it. There are leaders all over scripture who, I mean, they just did not get it. They did not understand that success by the world's definition and all of the glitz and the glam recognition, it was feeding something in them that really needed to be put to death, their pride. Oh, yes. And that to me is what hustle culture does. Hustle culture is feeding something inside of us that needs to be starved. And if we don't realize that, then we are building this robust pride inside of us that is going to eventually starve the other parts of our lives that need to be fed. That is how we're healthy. So to me, it's all about knowing, listen, the reason that I feel like, what does it boil down to? What is the reason you feel like you need to hustle? When you can acknowledge whatever that is, it usually boils down to a few things. One, people pleasing. And really all of these are just extensions of our own pride. But one is people pleasing. One is maybe provision. And I think that a lot of us, it is one of the most expensive times to be alive right now. I'm telling you, it is so expensive to be alive. And so I think we are hustling hard to meet the bottom line and to make the money we need to make. And when you think about people pleasing and when you think about provision, if you feel like you have to please everybody and if you feel like you have to provide for yourself, then the root issue of that is, do you trust God? Like, is it a trust issue? And if it's a trust issue, man, you can just go straight to God's words. It's, I don't want to say it is an easy fix, but it is a simple fix.
Right.
You cannot get to know God better and not trust God more. It is impossible to get to know God better and not also trust him more as you're getting to know him better. So it, bring it all back. Hustle is probably a trust issue, and the way to fix, the medicine you can feed, is God's word and getting to know him and getting to understand who he is. And that's at your fingertips. You can do that anytime, anywhere.
Absolutely. And I love what you said, that it's impossible. It's impossible not to get him to know him more and not trust him more. And I feel that that's exactly what you're saying, but the hustle steals our time of getting to know him more. And I find that when I'm struggling the most, I'm being pulled and pulled away from slowing down and making that time.
Right.
And I see it, you know, for my family, like the extension of what we're showing our kids. And that's what it's becoming, where our kids are in that hustle because we have them in that hustle.
Right.
And I, you know, I've always strived to really not let my kids feel the pressure of, you don't want to do that, I get, no problem. Like, you know, like there's a, it's hard to say no. Everyone, you know, there's so many things we can say yes to every day. But you said on one of your podcasts I listened to, you had a guest, and I think it was the guest that said it, was, you know, in order to, you know, nurture your home life, you got to be home.
Yes. And I was like, in the part time. Yes.
Yes. It was so much truth, because I feel like you have to go against the grain to get that time at home, you know?
Right. Right.
And to get the time in the word, like you said, like you got to go against, sorry, I'll be there in 30 minutes.
Right.
I got something to do first.
Absolutely.
So that's really good. I talking about your book, I want to shift to your book now, because the book is so good. And I followed you for years. And honestly, this year, that's one of my things for this year, to read more, because again, time, everything takes it away. And the last few years, I haven't read as much. And my husband gave me Audible for a gift. And wow, that's been life-changing for me, because I'm at that stage of in the car. But the problem is I listen to the book on Audible and then I'm like, oh, I have to get it. So then I buy the book because I want the book. But chapter 5, I'm going to go straight to chapter 5 because I loved it. Obedience over success.
Yes.
There's a lot of good in this whole book, front to back. But that chapter, if you could talk, and you've already talked a little bit about it, but there's so, you give examples in there and you go to a story in the Bible, what obedience looks like and what disobedience looks like. If you could touch on that a bit.
Yeah, sure.
It was good.
The whole point of that chapter was to help women understand that we define success, especially in the Western culture, in a very unhealthy way. And as believers, it is completely wrong. It is completely false. And so what would it change for us to define it the right way, to understand that when we are obedient to what God is asking of us, to what he is calling us to do in our lives, when we are showing up to the places he is asking us to show up to, and when we are loving the people that he has put us around to love, then that is success. And that is the kind of success that won't necessarily bring you earthly merit, but it may. I mean, I find so much joy in my obedience here on earth. But what it'll do even more than the paycheck or the title or the second home or the fancy vacation is, man, kingdom, the kingdom impact that it will make. And I thought about this the other day. I can't remember who I was talking to, but we were talking about how amazing it will be to get to heaven and to see the lives that perhaps you've impacted while on earth that you didn't even know. You had no idea that case. But then the beauty of it is you get to heaven and you find out these stories, but you're made new, you're perfect. So your pride can't even get in the way. You can actually fully celebrate in heaven when you see these things happen. But we've got to keep that eternal lens. We've got to be able to see heaven. We've got to be able to understand the bigness of God and his kingdom so that we can redefine things like obedience being what it is to have success in our lives. And this is one of the greatest parenting lessons that I have ever been able to acknowledge and hopefully impart to my children, is what you think the world wants from you and what you think you need in order to look like a successful, put together adult or human being. I really need you to evaluate those things and stack them against God's word and what it is that he wants from us, how he defines success. And then I need you to lean into his definition. I need you to lean into what he wants for you. And there is, as a believer, so much freedom in that. Because once you're following the Lord, if you're striving for success in any way other than the success that God wants for you, man, you are swimming upstream. You are going against the current. And we wonder why, you know, it's tense and it's difficult and there's stress involved. Well, I mean, we're doing it to ourselves. We're doing things that we know aren't best. And you can't live with one foot in and one foot out. You've got to be all in to what God is asking.
Wow. Yes. So good. But when I go to the God is asking, and I'm sure you've talk about this a lot, I feel like, and I've talked about it a lot with so many people, is when you sit in it and you're like, is he asking me to do this? Is he not? Is that him asking? You know, the listening and how to know when he is asked, are we in the right place? And sometimes I feel like we are swimming upstream, but then sometimes I feel like he is asking me to do that hard thing. And I'm trying to decipher. Can you guide us in it at all on that, Somer, with your wise words?
I will do my very best. You guys need to know just my personal nature before I tell you the way I handle this thing, because it might not be best practice for everyone. Because the bottom line of this is you want to be able to discern the voice of the Lord over everything else. I think that's right. What we're really asking for is that we truly can hear the voice of God different and louder and than anything else, which is, it's a practice. It's a spiritual maturity. I'm sure that he can do it in us when we're young. He can just, you know, automatically abracadabra, this is my voice, here it is. But for some reason, in my situation and in most circumstances of my friends and women that I've discipled, that hasn't been the experience. It's a practicing and learning the voice of God and hearing him, which is, you know, getting familiar with him, going back again to getting to know him really well, so that then he is a familiar voice. It's like when you're in a crowd at a park and there's like a million kids, but everybody's screaming for mom, and you know exactly when it's your kid that's screaming for mom.
Mm-hmm.
We want we want to be able to hear his voice. Here's what I'll tell you though, as I was learning God's voice, what I would typically do is run into whatever I thought that I was maybe supposed to do. If it wasn't going to harm anyone else, and if it was a, if it wasn't going to harm anything else, I think that was probably my only, the only thing that I really stopped me. I would just say yes. And I would pray really bold, big prayers. God, I've been asked to do this, or this opportunity has opened, this door has opened. I'm going to run through it until you shut it. And I am fine if you slam it in my face, even if it hurts okay. a little bit. But like, close the door if I'm not supposed to step into this. And I just started, instead of asking the Lord to tell me yes or no, when I thought it was possibly him, I said yes, and then asked him to just say no. And so far it's been working.
I like that though. I like that approach. Right. Yeah. And that helps both of it, getting to know him better. And I would absolutely say that helps. I feel like, just spending more time, getting more closer, reading his word, all of that helps. But just saying yes, if it's not hurting anything. And I do pray for those doors to be slammed in my face, but I like that, to say I'm all in, and you just shut me down. If this isn't where I'm supposed to be, I'm good with that.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's good. I like that. Good. Very much. Cause you also talk in the book a lot about, his way over my way.
Yeah.
And I feel like I've, when you just brought up freedom, it made me think of that. And because I read something else recently, and I keep reading about freedom keeps coming up in my